Okay, welcome to this online lecture series. Good evening here in Hong Kong. I think good morning in Florida. So today we are joining here for the seventh lecture in this lecture series, online lecture series on the story of Chan, history, literature, teachings, and practices. Organized by our Center of Buddhist Studies, University of Hong Kong, and sponsored by Glorious Sun Charity Foundation. The speaker, I think I don't need to give much introduction, so you're already familiar with. Professor Mario Poceski, the University of Florida. So Professor Poceski is a professor of Buddhist Studies and Chinese Religions, and he received his PhD in East Asian Languages and Cultures and with a specialization in Buddhist studies from the University of California. And he has been the professor of Buddhist studies and Chinese religion at the University of Florida so for many years. And he has been traveling in various places and giving his lectures in world-known universities. Professor Poceski, I think as you have already come to know that he is basically combining his theories, practices, and personal experiences through this lecture series. I think without much spending time on this, I will invite Professor Poceski to deliver his today's lecture.
Thank you for the introduction. Also, thank you for facilitating this opportunity to talk about these topics. This is number seven in the series, and we will be doing three more and then wrap it up. And I think by that time, we will have pretty good coverage of the Chan tradition in terms of its and historical developments, texts, ideas, place within Chinese Buddhism, and so on. As it has been so far, and it's going to be continued until the end of the series, I'm not really that much focusing on contemporary practices, traditions, teachers, and so on. But again, I do think these have contemporary relevance in as much as this is still a living tradition. So I hope you can draw those connections. Last week, I was talking about monasticism and the place of monasticism within the Chan tradition and the way Chan masters, Chan monastics, participated in the gradual evolution of Buddhist monasticism in China. And the argument, I made many arguments, but the main line of argument that I was trying to articulate is that Chan, the emergence of Chan didn't represent a radical paradigm shift in the nature, scope, tenor of Buddhist monasticism in China, which is kind of more traditionalist interpretation. But that really was part of a gradual evolution of monastic ideals, practices, and institutions, and the Chan school participated in those processes, exerted important role, brought new elements to Chinese religious life, especially in the monastic sphere. Of course, that goes beyond that, or it's tied up with developments in other spheres. But that really ultimately they didn't represent rejection of the Vinaya tradition or a radical departure, but the gradual process in which the Chan tradition participated from within. One of the things that I mentioned that is also worth thinking about is the role of lay people in this whole process. So this lecture is kind of following on lecture six. I'm going to be talking about lay people, basically, about lay models or lay modes of engagement with Chan teachings and practices, focusing on the literati, which was the main audience, also the audience that wrote about it. So we have more information about how people the upper echelons of Chinese society, especially poets, writers, and so on, which in China also usually were also officials in the imperial bureaucracy, participated in the development of Chan, engage with Chan masters, learn some of them, practice, and so on. But as I do that, I'm also going to approach this development of lay models of Chan practice by looking at Chan poetry. And in this case, not so much poetry composed by Chan monks, so I'm going to mention some of that, but poetry composed by lay people who were either inspired by Chan or who engage or try to reflect on their own experiences or give some share some of their ideas about the nature of Chan practice and so on. So here we have basically two themes, it's Chan and poetry and lay models of Chan practice among the Tang literati. And again, as I do with most of this, I'm focusing on the Tang dynasty for reasons that I already explained. So let me start by bringing up a poem. In one of my previous lectures, the lecture on Chan literature, I mentioned the role of poetry, both didactic poetry composed by Chan monks, but also other types of poetry written by or composed by secular poets, of which I'm going to give you some examples today. In terms of providing information, using that as a source of information for understanding Chan history, teachings, practices, experiences, and so on. And one of the poems that I briefly mentioned was Fate in Mind. So this is the opening lines. So we went over this. So Fate in Mind, or Mind of Fate, or Trusting Mind, there are different ways of translating the term Qin Qin. So it starts with the ultimate way, the Tao. The form of Tao is not difficult. All you have to do is to avoid picking and choosing. So this is kind of about non-discrimination, non-attachment, developing equanimous frame of mind. So I'm not going to go to this. And one of the other things I was trying to do that is to also go over the closing lines of the poem. The poem itself is quite long, actually. It could be a topic for a whole lecture, but since we don't have time, but let me kind of go over the closing lines, which I plan to do during that lecture, but I ran out of time. So the main theme here is non-duality, a major concept in Buddhism, especially popular both among monastics and lay people during the Tang Dynasty. You find it in popular scriptures, such as the Vimalakirti scripture, which I mentioned and I'm also going to mention again today. And of course, this is an important concept that is found in Chan records. So, one is identical with all. All is identical with one. If only you can be like that, no need to worry about being complete. The mind of fate is non-dual. Non-duality is the mind of fate. As the way of words comes to an end, there is no past, future, and present. So there's much to unpack here. Again, topic for another lecture. This is in terms of going over the ideas communicated in this very popular poem. But basically, faith, first of all, faith and belief are two different concepts, both within Christianity and certainly kind of using the English words as starting points. So they are different connotations here. The field of the Chinese word is a little bit broader, so there's a wider semantic field, but going beyond that, so it starts here in this passage with this relationship between one, could be the person or individual phenomenon or thing, and the many. You find that quite a bit in Chinese Buddhist philosophy, perhaps most famously in Huayan Buddhism, but you find it also in Chan records and elsewhere as well. So this kind of notion of identity of one and many, or one and the world, the individual and the cosmos. And then if you can lead, be like that, it is to say, if you can live your life in accord with this understanding, then there is no need to worry about attainment, about perfection, and so on. And then the kind of the closing four lines is this kind of notion of non-duality is applied to the mind, not the ordinary mind, but the mind of faith. Again, faith here, not in a belief, all beings have Buddha nature, or belief the Buddha was a great sage, or belief the Four Noble Truths are the true and only true way of explaining the nature of the world and the nature of reality and the proper spiritual path and so on. But the mind of faith, in which faith arises from within this theoretical template, from the Buddha nature within, right? So it's the Buddha nature which is covered with defilement, which manifests itself, which permeates consciousness. And there is this kind of embrace of non-duality. So the mind of faith, you can say the true mind, as opposed to the discriminating mind, is non-dual. And non-duality itself points to this mind of faith. And then going back to the silence, which we find in Chan texts, of course, most famously in the Vimalakirti scripture, Vimalakirti's famous signs, as the way of words comes to an end. All distinctions, including the distinctions of time, past, present, and the future, disappear, right? So this is kind of sense of freedom that is realized through the achievement of non-duality, right? So putting that in a historical context, I already spoke quite a bit about Tang Dynasty Buddhism as I was talking about the development of Chan. And by and large, Tang Buddhism have been described as the golden age of Buddhism in China. That's traditional interpretation. Over the last several decades, some scholars, mostly American scholars, have been challenging this. Kind of it's a debate, not a very important one, frankly, especially outside of narrow Buddhist circles, whether Tang is the golden age or not. Looking at the records and so on, I think it's a no-brainer, it was, but that doesn't mean that other periods are not important and that they shouldn't be studied and that they stood within this larger historical trajectory of the development of Buddhism in China. But basically, going back to the Tang, certainly Buddhism is flourishing, it's Buddhist monks and monasteries are all over the place. If you look at the urban map of Chang'an, the main capital of the Tang Dynasty, there are Buddhist monasteries all over the place. We have name of well over 100 monasteries in the capital, and some of them are really huge, both in terms of size and also magnificent in terms of the decoration, the statues, the art, and so on. And of course, there are also Buddhist monasteries in various provincial areas, famous mountains, and so on. And in terms of participation, you have people from all levels of society, common people, intellectuals or officials, all the way up to the upper echelons of Chinese society at the time, including not all, but most emperors during this period. So this is a period of great cultural effervescence. I mean, I've been thinking on and off of writing a book, more popular book, about something with the title of when China was the center of the world, kind of using the Tang Dynasty and analyzing what was so great. Again, it's not perfect society. There were problems. The dynasty almost collapsed in the middle with the An Lushan rebellion and so on. But by and large, this was a period of great cultural effervescence, intellectual creativity, and Buddhism was very much a part of it. Actually, it was one of the major parts of this unparalleled cultural flourishing. And also during this period, this creativity is reflected in the development of major traditions of Chinese Buddhism. Tian Taiyo already develops, kind of at least in its nascent form, just before the Tang during the Sui Dynasty, but certainly there are developments also in the Tang, but Sanlun, Fa Xiang, Chan, Huayan, Pure Land all reach their mature forms or to develop their teachings, their outlooks, their practices during this very, very important period. And most of the famous philosophers, meditators, and so on that left indelible mark on Chinese Buddhist history lived during this period, whether it's Jizang of the Sanlu school, whether it's Xuanzang, various Chen masters, Huayan philosophers such as Fazan, Chen Quan, Shantou Pure Land advocates, and so on. Tang also happens to be about the golden age of Buddhism, you can say the golden age of Chinese civilization as a whole, and also the golden age of Chinese poetry. So this is the period when most of the greatest poets in Chinese history are active. And because Buddhism is flourishing, because Buddhist monasteries and monks are all over the place, because Buddhist ideas capture the public imagination, unsurprisingly, we find lots of influences, so lots of references, or lots of intersections between Buddhism and various elements of Chinese worldviews or culture perspectives within the poetry of major Tang poets. So these are some of the names, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the first two, Wang Wei, Bojuyi or Baijuyi, Du Fu, Li Shangyin, Li Hua. So these are major figures in the cultural sphere, and especially known for their poetry. Of course, they write non-poetic pieces, some short prose pieces, and so on. So this is very much a period where we have these intersections between Buddhism and poetry within the context of Tang culture. And of course, Chan, this is also the period when Chan emerges to the fore and it's becoming the major tradition of Buddhism in China, or a major tradition perhaps, because this is also a period when, for example, Huayan, at least until the mid ninth century, is flourishing as well. So when we think about the intersections between Buddhism and poetry, or Chan and poetry, we have to keep in mind that the lines between what is Chan and what is Buddhism in a more generic sense are not always clear cut, especially in the realm of ideas, images, metaphors, and so on. So this often, for example, Wang Wei is described as a Buddhist poet, and more specific, Chan poet, and the same with Bojuyi. But of course, they were not necessarily thinking in narrow sectarian terms, like I'm a Chan Buddhist, or rather than, I don't know, the entire Buddhist or generic Buddhist or anything of that sort. So keep in mind this caveat that the boundary between what is Chan and what is more general Buddhism, whether it's scriptural Buddhism, ideas derived from, I don't know, the Huayan Qing or the Vimalakirti scripture, ideas current within Buddhist intellectual circles, it's not very, very clear cut, right? So having said that, let's explore this relationship between Tang literati and Buddhism, and with special reference to Chan, which is the main topic for today or for the whole series. So I already mentioned a number of famous officials or literati in the context of the previous lectures. And it's partly because many of them were deeply involved with Chan monks and monasteries. They wrote inscriptions and so on, as I'm going to point in a moment. But above all, they were the patrons for Buddhist monks and monasteries. So if you study the life of particular Chan masters, there will be references to various lay people, especially high officials or important literary figures that came to the monastery that offered support, that came to learn and so on. So there is this role of literati as patrons of Buddhist monks and monasteries, and that includes Chan monks and monasteries. We also have records, for example, after the Emperor's Wu persecution of Buddhism, for example, Pei Xiu goes to the monastery of Guishan and he repairs the monastery and he goes there. I mean, he's in official capacity, he's assigned to administer the particular area where the monastery is, and then the monastery has been destroyed and he organizes to be rebuilt and so on. So this is just one example of that sort of patronage. But also, the literati are major recipients of Buddhist teachings, especially the teachings of Chan masters. There was an egalitarian impulse in Chan studies, that kind of Chan was somehow egalitarian tradition that tried to open the gates to enlightenment for everybody. And theoretically, yes. I mean, of course, it's open to everybody. But if you look at the tradition, most of the monks and also the audience outside of monastic environments that received these teachings were upper class people, so for better or worse. So it was not particularly egalitarian, at least in that sense, in terms of social hierarchy and structure in the context. And that's quite understandable if you look at Tang society as a whole at the time. So the literati become recipients of Buddhist teachings. And this is the important part, because in the last lecture, I was talking about the importance of understanding the monastic context in which Chan teachings were articulated. And that's certainly very, very important. Chan masters, so almost all of them were monastics. And of course, they were leaders of monastic community. They articulated their teachings within that context. And that context is very important for understanding the ideas that they try to communicate. But another important audience were the literati, both in terms of the sermons, the teachings, but also in terms of when Chan records, for example, are compiled, there's also an audience that is kept in mind. So in that sense, when you speak, for example, I'm giving a lecture now, I mean, in this case, actually, I don't know exactly what the audience is. I don't know. There are a few thousand people, I presume, now listening. I don't know where they're coming from, but within that context, but like if I write something or if anybody writes, usually have some kind of audience in mind. And when you think about the audience, you try to shape your message in ways that will meet the horizons of expectations of that audience, maybe appeal to them, or maybe communicate certain ideas that you think are important to address for the sake of that audience. And this is very, very important. And when we read Chan texts, I mean, of course, you can read it in a decontextualized context and have kind of this kind of direct relationship with the text if you want, and some literary theory suggests that's the way that usually happens. But in terms of understanding at least what the intent was, obviously we can never fully know what, you know, the authors of this text actually had in mind. They themselves clearly knew. I mean, it's complicated. They might have had different ideas or different agendas, but still, there is an audience there when Yuan Wu writes the commentaries on Bi and Lu on various koans. He is really targeting specific audience, and he tries to appeal to that audience, not just in the content, but also in the use of language, what kind of language he uses, try to cater to the literary tastes or expectations of the audience and so on. So this is very, very important that Tang literati are recipients of Buddhist teachings, especially Chan teachings. Also, like many people in the Tang, they were also involved in personal practice. So this was not just a tradition that they tried to learn or explore or kind of be curious about, but this was for many of them, religion that they try to follow in the context of their daily lives. So we have lots of records of personal practice, and we're going to talk about it in a moment as we look at some of the poets. So we have examples of poets or literati talking about their meditation practice, about chanting, about studying the scriptures. And also if you look at some of the literature they produce, it's quite obvious that, for example, Wang Wei was quite well-versed, at least with some Buddhist texts. And there is reference to specific texts, to specific doctrinal terms, and so on, which seems to indicate engagement with at least some scriptures. But in addition to providing patronage for Chan monks and monasteries and being important audience, the literati were also important actors in the development of the Chan tradition. I already mentioned the writing of stele inscriptions for Chan monks. I gave you a few examples. In my previous lectures, there was passages from Matsu's stele inscription, which was composed by Chuan De Yu. And then I also gave you examples from several passages from Wei Quan's inscription, which was composed by Bo Jui around 815. So this is very important because in many instances, these are the earliest records about the lives of important Chan monks from the Tang Dynasty. This is common. Most inscriptions actually for famous Chan monks are written by noted literati. There are examples of literati actively participating in the recording of Chan teachings. Prime example that they also already mentioned in previous lecture is Pei Xiu's recording and editing of the sermons and dialogues he had with Huang Po. Huang Po was a major Chan master from the second half of the Tang Dynasty, kind of first half of the 9th century. And to this day, actually, this is one of the most influential Chan texts. For me, this is one of the first Chan texts that I read. This was translated in English in the 60s by '50s, by John Blofield. And so I first read it in English, and I was very greatly interested. And part of the reason, actually, I started to study Chinese when I was like 18, 19 years old on my own, I kind of moved to Hong Kong at the time, was to be able to read this particular text and some other kind of related texts by other Chan masters from roughly the same period. So this is important text to this time, really. Pei Xiu was very very important participant in the development. I mean, actually, he created the text. Maybe the records, the teachings might be Huang Po's by and large. So we have no 100%. We cannot be 100% sure, you know, about how much he edited or changed. But let's assume he was just recording. But still, he was very important agent in the creation and transmission of this text, and by extension, the teachings of Huang Po. He also wrote some stuff by himself, actually, which is also worth of reading. Also, if you look at the compilation of important Chan chronicles, here the prime example will be Jingde Chuan Deng Lu. So, I mean, usually it's ascribed to Tao Yuan, which was a Chan monk. But as scholars have looked in the historical context of the creation of this huge and hugely important chronicle of Chan up to the early 11th century, they found out that they were important lay people who were very important participants in the editing process and the compilation of the various materials that went into this particular text, which to this day is one of the most influential records of Chan history, Chan teachings, and so on. What do we find if we look at the writings of various literati that have survived over the centuries? So what kind of information do we find about Chan? Or more broadly, Buddhism. Well, there are depictions of monastic settings. So there, for example, a poet so-and-so goes to such and such monastery and he describes the settings. And that could be a source of information about what monasteries were like, what was happening there, how literati engaged or went to the monastery, some of the activities, the interactions between secular individuals, officials, cultural figures, and monks, and so on. Then there are also quite a few poems and prose pieces about also, for example, in the still inscription, sometimes the author describes his interactions with the monk for whom he writes an inscription. For example, I met the master in such and such time, and this, and, or for example, in the when we look at the still inscription for Wei Quan, there is not only brief reflections on Bojui's personal experience with Wei Quan, but there are also records of discussions they had, some dialogues between the two, which are quite interesting and important source of information about Shan and its relationship with the rest of Buddhism. I mean, I showed you some passages from those. I think maybe lecture 5, but I might be wrong. You can sometime earlier. So we have those kind of records of interactions. And then there are records of personal experiences with Chan practice about reflections on their study of Buddhist texts more generally, maybe also reflections on engagement with the ideas of particular Chan teachers, or maybe personal practice of meditation and so on. And these are very important sources of information about how Chan was understood. And also because the narrative mode is different, whether it's a prose piece or the literatus is describing his own personal experience at some point in his life, or maybe it's a poem in which he's reflecting on his life, his experiences, his hopes, aspirations, tribulations, and so on. This is kind of very important because Chan texts often lack this kind of personal tone or personal reflection. Many of them are formulaic, many of them are kind of presented in a sermon form, which have a kind of impersonal character and so on. So this is very, very valuable source of information about how people at the time, at least certain type of person, educated, sophisticated, upper class, with good ability to write well and so on, how they perceived Chan teachings, how they engaged, how they processed the theory and practice of Chan or Buddhism more generally. So let me give you some examples of these sorts of engagements with Chan teachings by noted literati. Let me start by Wang Wei. Sometimes he's referred to as the Buddha of poetry, Shifo, or the layman of layman Mojie. Mojie comes from the name of Vimalakirti, and this is another topic that might be worth a whole lecture about the importance of the Vimalakirti scripture in the context of both Chan and Tang dynasty Buddhism more general, maybe even Chinese Buddhism. We don't have to just limit to the Tang dynasty. But again, we don't have time for that. But basically, but here he takes this name, indicates that he was very, very serious about Buddhist practice, and he was very devout and very pious in terms of his approach to Buddhism, and that Vimalakirti, the main hero of the scripture with the same name, was a very important model for his spiritual life. Wang Wei is poetic genius, obviously one of the best known poets, the most influential poets in the history of Chinese poetry. But his artistic talent go beyond poetry. He's said to have been a great musician, wonderful painter, also known for his calligraphy. So we can say almost like I don't know if this is a good comparison, but maybe you tell me, but something like 9th century Chinese Leonardo da Vinci or something along those lines. So in his writings, he articulates his predilection for reclusion. He buys an estate at Jungnan Mountain, which is south of Chang'an. He spent lots of time there. And this information about his personal involvement with Buddhism, there have been debates in scholarly circles about when he talks, because traditionally he's understood as somebody who was influenced by Chan Buddhism. Some scholars have been suggesting that really, yeah, it was not really Chan, it was more generic Buddhism. But again, I don't have time to go into all these details and debates, but I can keep in mind the boundary between Chan and Buddhism. The rest of Buddhism is not clear-cut. So I would say he was definitely involved in Buddhism, and Chan was part of it. Definitely it was influence on him, but just to restrict him or to put him in the narrow rubric of Chan-inspired poet, at least for part of his corpus, yeah, probably that's a little bit restrictive. So, so if you look at his, I mean, he writes many different styles on very many different themes and so on. So not all of his poetry kind of reflects the impact of Buddhism, but certainly many of his poems you can find infusion of Buddhist ideas, notions of reclusion, notions of detachment, non-duality, emptiness, quest for transcendence of the mundane realm, or quest for reconciling, participation in the mundane realm with this otherworldly outlook that aims to transcendence. So let me give you an example of a poem by Wang Wei. So this is a poem that describes a particular event in his life. There's a monastery at Fufu Mountain, which you can visit. I've never been there, but I was just looking at some pictures. Actually, it looks quite nice. So maybe if I have a chance to go to China again, I would like to visit. But so there's a monastery there, and he invites the monks to his cottage, the place he lives. And then he describes the visit of the monks and also his response to that visit. So that's the Chinese of the text, and this is the translation. Late in life, I know the principle of purity. As with each day, I grow distant from the crowd. So this kind of sense of reclusion, distance, which appears in a number of his poems. As I weigh the moles coming from the distant mountain, I sweep my decrepit hut before their arrival. This is common trope, you find. I mean, Chinese poetry is not a major area of my expertise, but from what I can see, this kind of self-depreciating or my humble abode, my humble heart, even though in most instances, these were people who were quite well off. So probably it was not as humble and probably there were some servants around. Anyway, so I sweep my discrepant heart before their arrival. As they come down from the cloudy peak, they visit me in my overgrown abode. Sitting on the straw cushions, they eat pine seeds. As the incense burn, they read scriptures. Then the lamps are lit as the day comes to a close, while the temple bell marks the beginning of the night. Once awakened to serenity, there is joy. In this life, there is an overabundance of leisure. As thoughts about my native place return, why they must be profound. Our lives in this world are just empty of self-nature. So this kind of evoking at the end the notion of emptiness. But ladies and gentlemen, Wouldn't you like to join him and this kind of, as I was reading this? By the way, sorry, this was something new. I was preparing some new materials. I spent lots of time in these lectures. I hope it shows at least to some degree. There are all kinds of issues in terms of the text, there are discrepancies in terms of different edition characters and so on. And this is, I was also creating my own translation, so may not be perfect. I wish I had more time, and hopefully I will have time to go into this more often. But basically, so he had these kind of beautiful images of solitary life, of cloudy peaks, of monastery up in the mountains, of monks coming, of incense burning, of the sound of scriptures, of lamps being lit with the approach of the night and the temple bell in the distance. So these kind of beautiful images, and then a sense of serenity, joy, this kind of sense of leisurely approach to life, away from the crowds, from the bustle and hustle of everyday life. I don't know what other people get when they read this kind of stuff, but for me it's like, it's time to hit the mountains, to rent some kind of cottage myself and go there and spend some time with the clouds and the streams and the waterfalls and the birds and so on. And of course, my own thoughts, or hopefully the ending of thoughts. So there are of course more examples, maybe interesting to look at some of the Dufu's poems, but we don't have time for that. But let me kind of go into a little bit more detail by looking at two important poets from the Tang era that are closely and unambiguously associated with Chan Buddhism. The first one is Bojui, or Baijui if you prefer. He's also known as Xiangshen Zhushi, or the layman of Xiangshen. I'm going to explain what Xiangshen is. It's a place name, actually a monastery name. This was a monastery that was associated, and he was very dedicated to the master and the community there, and he took this name as the layman of Xiangshan towards the end of his life. And then the second one is Pang Yun, perhaps the best known Chan poet of all time. I'm going to read you a passage. But before we do that, let's look at some of the calligraphy there, some of the imagery. And I don't know where you find yourself. I live in Florida, so there are no mountains here. I have to drive north for 400 miles to North Carolina to get some mountains. And unfortunately, my schedule is very busy now. I cannot do it. But let's try to imagine ourselves, if you're not in a mountain, let's try to imagine some kind of mountain. And you go there and kind of put you in the mood about imagining some kind of mountain scenery that you might be familiar with. Even better if it's a mountain in China, because we are talking about Chinese mountains here. So the year, and then kind of, and also if you can divorce yourself from the present day context of your lives and transport yourself to the year of 815. As a matter of fact, if you have been to Lushan, which is a mountain in the northern part of Jiangxi, it's one of the most famous mountains in China, transpose yourself to Lushan Mountain and transpose yourself to the year 815. And then let's see what Bojui have to say. So this is from very important text. It's a prose text, actually, the record of the thatched cottage. So he describes his cottage at Mount Lushan. So in 815, he is kind of demoted to official posting in what is now northern Jiangxi province, the area where Lushan is located. At first, he's kind of not very happy. in Tang China, Chang'an, maybe to smaller degree, Luoyang, maybe less so during this period. Chang'an is the place to be. It's a place of culture. It's where you have lots of important people, but also, you know, if you're Buddhist, all kinds of monasteries and monks and so on. And he's kind of sent to this somewhat remote area. And then he's originally perhaps not that happy to be there, but then he looks around and he says, "My Lord, this place is wonderful." So, and then he relates his experience there. So I'm going to read from his text, or at least from my translation of his text. "The unique beauty of Lushan is foremost among all mountains in all the world. In the northern part of the mountain, there is a peak called Incense Burner. The monastery north of that peak is called Monastery of Bequeathed Love. The area between the peak and the monastery is absolutely superb, the best at Lushan. In the autumn of the 11th year of the Yuanhe era, I, Bo Le Tian of Taiyuan, fell in love with it as soon as I saw it. I was like a traveler gone away to faraway places who, passing through his home place, becomes reluctant and cannot leave." So the poet goes to the mountain, he looks around and he says, "This is absolutely wonderful." And then he looks to the north, this peak, and as you can imagine, there is a monastery there. And he looks at the area between and he says, "This place is stunning, the best I've seen." So he is really blown away, you can say. So what does he do? Well, he decides to build himself a cottage. So, continuing. "Consequently, I build a thatched cottage facing the peak and just beside the monastery. In the spring of the following year, the thatched cottage was completed. It had three sections with two pillars forming two rooms with four lattice windows. Its spaciousness was perfect, in accord with my desires and resources. In the center of the cottage, I placed four wooden couches, two silken screens, one like a chin, and books on Confucianism, Taoism, and Buddhism, two or three volumes each." So inspired by the natural beauty of the place, he decides to build himself a cottage, like a weekend house or something. And then this is a place, of course, where he can be close to nature. It's a place of reclusion, reflection. Perhaps he can meditate there, but it also becomes a place actually for social activity, because the monks from the nearby monasteries can come, some of his literati friends can come, they can maybe discuss poetry, they can talk about Buddhism and so on. And I would like to draw your attention to the last part of the last sentence: books on Confucianism, Taoism, and Buddhism, two or three volumes each. Now, this is perhaps formulaic, but it kind of indicates something that really is important for understanding not just Tang Buddhism, but Tang religiosity in general. So here's 815. If our poet was somewhere in northern France or Germany or, I don't know, Prague area during this period, and he built himself some kind of cottage in the mountains, he certainly wouldn't write that he placed, he in the middle of the cottage, he placed a book on Christianity, Islam and Buddhism. That would be absolutely no-no, because especially, let's say, if it's during the, this is the time of Charlemagne, actually, in Europe, there's only one real religion, and you don't have choice. You have to follow it. There's no no other way. Charlemagne gave, when he kind of defeated some of the tribes, he gave them the choice, Christianity or the sword on your head, or cutting your neck, right? So this points to this kind of embrace of religious pluralism in China, and also it's indicative of the way that people, especially literati and poets like Bai Zhu, engage with religion and spirituality. So by and large, you can read or understand Bo Zhu Yi as a devout Buddhist. I'm going to show you examples of that. It's very clear that he was very dedicated to Buddhism, but he was not a Buddhist exclusivist. That really, if you look at both his life and his writings, there's appreciation for Confucianism, references to Taoism, and so on. And I'm going to come to that in a moment. But first, this is a modern recreation of the cottage where Bai Zhu lived during this period. I don't know, I was there a while ago. I don't know what it looks now, but property is full of tourists. I mean, there were some tourists already at that time, which was not too bad, but in China now. I don't know, maybe you can tell us in the chat how it is now, but anyway, so you have the statue of the poet and a modern recreation of the cottage, supposedly at the site. So, but like, if you look at using the last part of the passage I showed you as an entry point, if you look at his religious persona, I mean, you realize that certainly Buddhism is a very important part of it, but it was not the only part. And like many of his contemporary, Bo Zhu had multifaceted and multi-layered persona, both in terms of engagement in other traditions rather than Buddhism, and also within Buddhism. He's mostly associated with Chan, but he was not Chan Buddhist in any meaningful sense. I mean, remember, this was the tradition that most inspired him, and certainly there are clear references to Chan in his poetry and other writings, but really, there are also records of his participation in other sorts of Buddhist activities. So all this informed his artistic sensibility, his approach to spirituality, his personal outlook, and so on. Certainly, he was educated in the Confucian tradition, like all upper-class Chinese during this time. He passed the Jinshi examination, he got a degree, he was active in the imperial bureaucracy. He actually became quite wealthy, not so much because he was writing poetry, but because he was high-ranking official in the Tang bureaucracy. And there's interest in Taoist philosophy as well, so you can have Taoist reading of Bo Zhu's poetry. Certainly he's familiar with the classics, especially Chuanzi, Dao De Jing. But above all, and most relevant to the topic of hand today, he was definitely a lifelong student of Buddhism, and especially he was interested in Chan Buddhism, as is clearly can be clearly seen from his artistic writings, including his poetry. There are records of his interactions with many monks, dozens of monks from very historical records, his own writings and so on. And that includes a number of important Chan masters from the early 9th century. The first one, Wei Quan, I already mentioned when I was I gave you in one of my previous lectures this translation of part of a dialogue between him and Wei Quan. Ruman, I'm going to talk about him in a moment. He was also Bodley, like Wake, when he was a disciple of Matsu. While Weikuan brought the teachings, or at least some of the ideas of the Hongzhou school, to Chang'an, the main imperial capital, Ruman went to Luoyan, which was the second Tang capital, and he spent the last period of his time at Xiangshen Monastery, which I already mentioned. Guizhong was also a fairly important Chan master, also a disciple of Matsu. His monastery was located Lushan, so probably he met with Bojun during this period, around 815 to 817, when he was posted there. And then there are some stories, and this becomes a motif in Chan or Zen-inspired art about the encounter between Bojui and Miao Ke, a bird nest, eccentric Chan master. There is this painting I showed you in one of the previous lectures as well. And there are other paintings on the same theme. And of course, he was also familiar with Zongmi, the famous Chan historian and writer, also known as Huayan Patriarch and so on. So this is quite a few important monks, which kind of indicates far-reaching engagement and familiarity with Chan teachings and practice, especially in the Hongzhou school, which is how I got into studying his poetry and writings, especially as they are relevant to understanding of Chan. So let me give you an example of a poem he wrote around the time when he built the cottage at Lushan. In terms of the story of his life, there is a progression. Definitely, he was a lifelong practitioner of Buddhism or devotee. But the intensity of his involvement of Buddhism definitely changed over time, becoming more intense and his commitment increasing and his enthusiasm for Buddhism, especially in its Chan idiom, growing over time. And by the end, I'm going to give you some examples of his late poetry. He is really fully engaged in Chan practice. So this is kind of somewhere mid-stage in his life, I guess you could say middle age. So this is a poem he writes for Li Jian. This is another literatus, actually. He appears in some of the Chan records from this period, written about him a little bit. So anyway, so this is kind of something he presents to this fellow literatus. It goes like this. In recent years, I've directed my mind towards the Chan of the Southern school. Outwardly, I follow the customs of the world. Within, I put aside entanglements of my immediate circle. And going outside, I do not dislike the court and public places. Returning home, I do not crave the company of men. Ever since I obtained this frame of mind, wherever I go, I'm at peace. Huan, not at peace, right? Double negation. First of all, he's very explicit in terms of identifying himself as somebody who is follower of Chan Buddhism, and especially the Southern school. There was this division between Northern and Southern school that have been discussed in the Nursium in various writings. So basically, one of the main themes here is this kind of sense of balancing between his public persona of official, of some of family man, of somebody who is engaged in the world, who goes to the court, goes to the public places, in the private sphere of his home life, of his spiritual practice, and so on. And the idea here is that he tries to synchronize or balance the two. So when he goes to the court and public places, he doesn't have aversion, even though that might not be, you know, his first choice, but kind of he still can participate fully in his life as a public figure and official in the imperial bureaucracy. But he doesn't crave this company of men. He's also embracing a life of solitude, a life of spirituality. And then he talks about the results. So because he says, since I kind of embrace this kind of attitude, or since I started to engage in this kind of practice, I achieve a state of peacefulness in my life. There's quite a bit, and this is why his writings are so important, because it gives you this kind of perspective of how an individual experiences this kind of practice, what effects it have on his life. Also, he writes about some of the challenges he faces. For example, he writes about his life of wine and how he reconciled this with Buddhist precepts and so on. So it's a wonderful source of information about Buddhist practice during this period, written from a very, very personal perspective, by somebody who is smart, who is articulate, who is sensitive, who is honest, and who have a sense of humor. So this is a passage from another poem, Winter Day. So he gets up early on a winter day and he starts chanting, right? So that's the image. And the poem goes like this. At night, practicing chan, I sit a lot. Affected by the autumn atmosphere, I chant. Leisurely, other than these two things, my mind does not dwell on anything else. So this is all he does. At night he's practicing chan. And chan here can be understood both in terms of Xue chan, in terms of the chan tradition, and in more generic sense of meditation, right? But since he already described himself as follower of the chan school, especially its kind of southern school form, it's clear that he's talking about meditation, but also associated it with a particular tradition within Chinese Buddhism, right? So the indication here is that he's fully committed to his practice, right? My mind doesn't dwell on anything else. So towards the end of his life, he retires. Well, first he kind of semi-retires, I suppose, so gets up, still have a position, probably doesn't do much work, and then he built himself a state in Luoyang, the secondary capital, and then he started to study Chan, but becomes very close to Ruman, this disciple of Matsu, who is living at the monastery in the Luoyang area. Actually, the monastery, I'm going to show you some images I've taken from a visit there some years back. Xiangshan Monastery, it's at the Longmen, one of the most important Buddhist sites in China, the complex of caves that perhaps some of you have visited. And if you haven't, I encourage you to do so in the future. So during this period, he kind of first semi-retires, then retires, and then he composes lots of poetry, and there is quite the importance of Buddhism is clearly increasing in his life. And this is one poem from this period. So this is a couple of years before Ruman, the monk I mentioned, dies. And so this is a period of intense spiritual practice by Bojui, and also during this period also he frequents the monastery, talks with the monks and so on. The title is interesting. Chuqia, leaving home, is a reference to becoming a monk, right? Chuqia Ren, person who have left home, is just a synonym for Buddhist monk, for He Shang or shaman, right? So basically, he compared himself to a chucharan, to a monk. He says, I am still at home, saicha, so at home, but I'm homeless, or homeless in a not a, a sense of a bum living in the street and begging, but in a monastic sense. So he kind of describes this in-betwixt kind of status he have at this time. He's definitely a lay person, but in his heart, he feels he is living a life that is very similar to the monks with whom he discusses very often Buddhism and he tracks and drinks tea and so on. So let's read the poem. Completely fixed for clothing and food, children married off, from now on, I'm not concerned with family matters. Getting rest at night, I'm like a bird being cast in the forest. At morning meals, I am one at heart with the monks going for alms. Clear cries, several voices, cranes among the pines, a spot of cold light, a lamp among the bamboo. Late at night, seated in the lotus position, I practice meditation. When my daughter calls or my wife cries out, I do not answer. So he is describing basically his life during this period. He is getting old. He's quite rich, living very comfortably. Comfortably fixed for clothing, food is a little bit of an understatement, but yeah, he's living a life of leisure, and he have this kind of sense of freedom. He can do whatever he wants. And like a bird in the forest. And what is he doing? He's sitting at night in the lotus position, practicing meditation. Maybe sitting also in the garden with a lamp along the bamboo, listening to the birds and so on. And he described himself in the fourth line, right? He described himself as being one. Like he eats breakfast and he thinks of monks going swap. So this is kind of sense of basically spiritually I feel I'm in tune with these monks, with monastic life and so on. So here you can see a deep sense of devotion to Buddhism, and that includes, of course, the practice of meditation. And from the context of his life and the associations with Ruman, with Changshan, we know the main source of inspiration during this period was Chan Buddhism, especially the variety of Chan that I've been mostly talking about during this lecture series. So this brings us to this ideal of exemplary lay practitioner, if you use Bodhi as somebody who embodies that. What is an exemplary lay practitioner doing? He's studying the Buddhist teachings, like studying scriptures, maybe chanting scriptures as well. He visits monasteries, he discusses Buddhism or Chan teachings with various Chan monks or other monks. He's introspective, he reflects on his lives, he reflects on his spiritual aspiration, but also on his desires, on his career, on his life, on his family. He reflects on the nature of mind, on reality. He cultivates a sense of detachment, but also try to incorporate Chan practice into daily life. And maybe this goes back to this notion of ordinary mind as the way, so how to be at home, both at the court or in public places or at one's workplace, and at home among the bamboo, among the lamp in the forest, among the silence of the meditation cushion and so on. And also there is a reflection of how to integrate one's spiritual endeavors, one's Chan practice with various cultural pursuits, including the composition of poetry. So there's kind of quite a bit of discussion of how to integrate poetic endeavors and artistic expression within the context of spiritual life shaped by Chan teachings and practices. So I mentioned Xiangshan Monastery. So this is an image of Xiangshan Monastery. It took some years back, as you know, it was all destroyed during the Cultural Revolution. I think this is newly rebuilt. I might be wrong. It was a while ago, but anyway, obviously it was not a functioning monastery. Now it has been rebuilt. It's probably the monastery with the best view in the world. So, yeah, the monastery is on the other side of the river, and then you have the Longmen caves. So this is basically what you see from the monastery. And if there were any doubts, like you say, well, he writes poetry about Chan, but maybe there was something else going on in his life, but really. If you look at one of the most important things we decide towards the end of his life is where we are going to die and where we are going to bury it and how we are going to be remembered. And actually what Bojui does is he asks his family to bury him at the monastery that he spent so much time going to and talking with monks. Actually, this is close to the stupa of Ruman, this Chan monk that I mentioned. And this is a picture I took of the, I don't know, this was some years back. I don't know if probably looks the same, but I don't know if they have done something else. So this is his tomb, actually. So it's just like from here, you go down the monastery. There's also a lovely garden, or used to be. I hope to go to again. Maybe it would have been nice actually to have this lecture at that particular site and to reflect and talk and observe. So hey, if somebody wants to organize that, we can all sign on. So this is, and then there is a passage in one of his poems composed during this period where he says, together with the clouds and the springs, I form karmic bonds in another life. I will be a monk at this mountain. So I don't know. Maybe the spirit of Bojui in a guise of a monk is still hovering around Xiangshan or Longmen. Let me know if you go and see it or feel it. Perhaps we can stop at this point, can have our customary 2-minute break, and then we can reconvene, and I'm going to talk a little bit more, maybe tell you a little bit more about Pangyu, the famous Chan name. All right, I think we can reconvene. I hope everything is okay in terms of the PowerPoint and so on, and you can hear me and see me. So on that assumption, let me continue. But before that, just a personal reflection. One of the things I've been thinking over the years, or one of the desires, maybe, or aspiration I've had is to teach a course on Buddhism, Chinese Buddhism and poetry, or maybe religion and poetry more generally. And just to spend a semester just reading poetry and talking about it. And I've never quite realized that aspiration so far. I've been also thinking of maybe it's nice to have some kind of poetry reading, maybe read some Chan poetry or maybe some Zen poetry from Japan or something like that. Yeah, that might be something that is nice to do. And also, as I was reading this, there's, of course, quite a bit materials on this already written about Chan and poetry and so on. But there's much more to be explored. And this was also something I was thinking in the past, not so much recently because of other projects now, but to delve into this world of medieval literati and their religious identities and spiritual outlooks and engagements with Buddhism, and to have a profile either of religious life during this period, or maybe also the intersections between Zen and poetry, maybe look at all these individuals I mentioned and have much more in-depth discussion, maybe do a book or something like that. So maybe as I was preparing the lecture, I kind of revisited some of those old ideas and maybe thought, if I can find time, that maybe something to do either the course or the poetry readings or writing more about it. But anyway, so if you look at this image of exemplary layman and a scribe, what's the basic model? Well, the basic model or the basic template in which you construct the image of ideal Chan layman, it's really something that I spoke about last week, is the monastic ideal, the model of exemplary layperson is based on the model of exemplary monks, with of course some variations or some adaptations to the circumstances and the context of lay life. So this points to the primacy of monastic ideals, mores, and practices. So when Bodhi is about to die and he reflects, so what's his aspiration? In next life, maybe I can finish this business of spiritual practice and realization. And it, maybe the best way to do that is to be reborn as a monk in this mountain, right? So in that sense, the Chan master is an exemplary religious figure, and lay practice is maybe approximation or adaptation on that model. So some of the teams we find, whether it's with Wang Wei or Bojie, certainly with Pang Yun, as I'm going to talk in a moment, is this sense of reclusion, going to outside of the busy marketplace or the world of business and commerce and bureaucracy and so on, and entering a realm of solitude. A contemplative endeavors, including formal practice of meditation, right? There are clear references to Zuo Chan, right? To sitting meditation. And proximity to monastics, going there, supporting monastic, engaging, having discussions, practicing together, learning from them, and so on. And this kind of patterning of exemplary the ideal of exemplary layperson on the monastic ideal is obvious when we look at the life and the poetry of the most famous Chan layman of all, Pang Yun, right? One of the earliest stories about his life is that at some point in his life, perhaps during the middle, what we could call middle age, so he has some kind of, maybe to use modern parlance, mid-age crisis. He have enough. From what we can tell, probably, he have a family by this time. He have a wife and two children. And he's relatively well off in modern context, America, maybe like upper middle class, maybe something like me here, I don't know. So, and at some point he decides to have enough of this kind of life, the rat race and the life of or ordinary endeavors and so on. So we don't know if the story is 100% sure, true, but according to some biographical sources, so he decides to bring about major change in his life, basically to go in the direction of more intensive practice of Buddhism. So he gets all his household possessions, takes a boat, goes to the middle of the river and dumps it everything. Kind of, maybe this is overly dramatized, but basically it indicates this kind of move away from ordinary life of a householder or ordinary person, with all the implications of that status or station in life, to life of simplicity that is dedicated to spiritual pursuits. And then he becomes a Jushe, a Buddhist layman, right? That's kind of specific status in Chinese Buddhism. And there are stories about him, especially with his daughter, but he seems to be also in tune with his choice. So he also does not marry and lives here with her father, and there are stories about them going to monasteries and engaging with Chan monks and also composing poetry, which is inspired by Chan ideals. So after he basically makes his own renunciation, right, and enters a kind of quasi-monastic or in between, Tai Cha Chu Chia kind of life of a Buddhist layman, he travels to various monasteries and studies with a number of noted Chan teachers. The most famous of them, and perhaps most influential in terms of his spiritual development, are Shito and Matsu. I spoke about Matsu and I mentioned Bang Yun in the context of his disciples. A discussion of his disciples, Shito was a contemporary of Matsu, very important Chan master. Maybe not so much during his lifetime, but definitely in terms of his stature grows over the centuries, because the Tao Tung, or in Japanese Soto school, basically traces his ancestry back to him. So in that sense, in terms of if you look at these lineage charts of Chan, he's one of the major figures featured in Chan genealogies. So, and then we know more about Pang Yun and his spiritual outlooks and endeavors and activities, because he have a poetic talent, and he expresses that by composing lots of poetry. A number of his poems survive to this day. And later tradition embraces him as the paradigmatic Chan layman. So if there's a model of what real Chan layman is, perhaps Pang Yun will fit that bill the best. But again, we have this kind of notion of lay person. He's not an ordinary lay person, the way we would understand it, or the way maybe we would have been understanding in the context of the Tang dynasty, because obviously, most lay people don't spend their lives traveling to monasteries, talking with Chan masters, giving up their wealth and possessions and so on, and composing Chan poetry, right? Much of his poetry is not particularly good in terms of its value as a poetry. It can be put into the category what I would refer to as didactic poetry. So basically, he's using poetic forms to express his Buddhist ideas. So this is one example of that. If you wish to attain the truth and become a Buddha, you should have no mind in regard to the mere things. As the mind is thus, external objects are also thus. And genuine wisdom comes out of thusness. Thusness genera, tatata in Sanskrit, right? Important Buddhist concept. The adornments of meditation, wisdom, and the like extensively expound the perfections, pervading thoughts, pervading throughout all realms in the 10 directions. They cannot be contaminated by anything existent. I announce to you, people who study the way, students of Buddhism or practitioners of Buddhism, if you are like this, you will become a Buddha. So kind of way of talking about Buddhist spirituality, about the quest for becoming a Buddha, for realizing Buddha. This is a poem I mentioned briefly in one of my previous lectures. I think during the second week I was talking about Matsu's conception of ordinary mind. This is supposedly a poem when he goes to meet Shito, and then he has some kind of insight into Shito's teachings, and then he composes this poem to express his understanding of Chan. I read it, but I think it's worth reading it again. So, my daily activity is not different. It's only that I'm spontaneously in harmony with it. That is to say, I don't do anything special. It's just whatever I'm doing, I'm in harmony with it. Not grasping or rejecting. Everywhere there is nothing to assert or oppose. This kind of resonates with Xin Xin Ming, the poem on the on the faith in mind, on the inscription on faith in mind. This kind of not grasping or rejecting, not asserting or opposing anything, abiding in neutrality. So, and then here, the next two lines, well, the next line is reference to the worldly realm of position of status, symbolized by the colors of the robes of officials in the Tang Dynasty, vermilion and purple. And then the next line is the mountains are without a speck of dust, so this kind of nature imagery, but also symbolizing a certain state of mind. And then the last two lines, the most famous one in the poem, supernatural powers and wonderful activity, fetching water and carrying firewood. In Buddhist scriptures, there's lots of, especially Mahayana scriptures, there are lots of references to the supernatural powers displayed by the Buddhas and various advanced bodhisattvas. And these people have lots of imagination. I mean, the stuff is really fantastic. All kinds of rays of light emitting and the whole earth shaking and kind of manifesting multiple bodies and so on. And that's part of the Buddhist imaginary, right? I mean, this is part of the worldly view, this kind of notion of spiritual powers and automaturgy and so on. It's part of the religious landscape, not just of Chinese Buddhism, but Chinese religion at the time. But he says, I'm not into any of that kind of stuff, whether understood literally or metaphorically. My supernatural powers or the sublime activity of perfected religiosity in its Buddhist idiom is to be expressed to ordinary acts, such as fetching water from the well and carrying firewood to your stove so that you can warm up your room, maybe some food or something like that. So this is an idea that they already discussed during the second lecture, where they talked about ordinary mind as the way and so on. I gave you some passages from the record of Matsu, also records of Linchi, and if you're interested, you can find it online. So please have a look if you haven't looked at it, or watch it again if you found it interesting. So this is an example of his understanding. So in the time I have, for a change, I'm not too much behind schedule. Let me read several more poems. First, let's read a couple of poems by Han Shan. I mentioned Han Shan, I think when I was talking about Chan literature, very briefly. So he's this famous recluse who wrote lots of poetry, and he is perhaps the best known Buddhist poem, a poet from the Tang Dynasty. He's often described as a Chan poet, but really kind of you have to stretch it and expand the meaning of Chan. It's kind of more generic. I mean, there's no indication that it was particularly associated or affiliated with the Chan school as a distinct tradition within Tang Buddhism. But as I've argued in places, there is this common outlook, shared sense of values, shared embrace of certain doctrinal templates about the Buddhist path, about the nature of mind and reality that is shared within the broader Buddhist milieu, at least at the elite level, of course, among the common people or popular Buddhism, maybe the scene is different. So he exemplifies that sort of outlook. So maybe I don't know, it's a nice poetry. So let's read a couple of his poems. So Han Shan is, the name, it comes from the mountain, literally means cold mountain. Of course, he's also, well, there are many translations in English. This is Punk's, he has been popular in Western circles, especially American Buddhist circles or poetic circles since the 60s. And then there are a number of translations and studies and so on. Right, so let's go to the point. I climb up the way to Cold Mountain, but the Cold Mountain road is endless. I climbed the path, I climbed the road up, but there is no end in sight. long valleys and boulders stacked stone upon stone. Broad streams thick with dense underground. The moss is slippery, the mosses are slippery, though there is, have been no rain. Slippery but no rain, that's strange. Pines cry out, you have the sound of the pines, which is beautiful. I suggest that go on. The sound of bamboo is also very nice, actually. I don't have pines in my garden, I have many more bamboo. There is no wind. Wow, how come? No wind, but still the bamboo are making sound, the pines are making sound. Who can get beyond worldly attachments and sit with me among the white clouds? So he's up on a mountain, climbing a path that leads to nowhere, or at least to no end. There is no end inside. Images of stones and streams and lush vegetation and moss and rain, but no rain. Sounds of wind in the pines, but no wind. And then there is a call to go beyond the everyday world of attachments, of mundane concerns, of egoistical fixations, and so on. But also a sense of loneliness, at least according to my interpretation, of being alone and inviting us, all of us, to join him, to go up the mountain and to sit among the white clouds. So another shorter poem by Hanshan with the calligraphy in the back. My mind is like an autumn moon, clearly reflected in a green pool. In fact, it's not compatible to anything at all. Tell me, how shall I explain? Indeed, how shall we explain our mind? One of the suggestions when I was formulating the lecture series was whether just to focus on China, to have a broader presentation of the Chan tradition that goes beyond China, maybe a little bit on Chan in Korea and Japan. So we had to eliminate some of the topics that I originally suggested. So we just focus on Chan Buddhism in China. But of course, there are things, interesting developments outside of China. So in that spirit, perhaps I can finish today's presentation by bringing about two poems by Ryokan, the famous Zen poet from Tokugawa, Japan. And there's a connection actually between Hanshan and Ryokan. Ryokan did read Hanshan's poetry and he was inspired by it, and he also lived a life of reclusion in Japan. He lived in a small hermitage in the forest, but at the same time he was going down the village and tracking with the people, especially the children and so on. And he wrote many poems about his experiences, about his encounters, about his thoughts, reflections, feelings, emotions, spiritual practices, and so on. And they're rich, they're beautiful. Some of the poems are in Chinese, classical Chinese, like the one we have here. And some of them are like, he also writes haiku and some are in Japanese. So let's read the poem. This is a poem I really like his poetry when I was young. Actually, did this during my monastic years, and I would read his poetry. And this is a translation by Stevens. Comes from this book. Not necessarily very literal in places, but kind of reads well. Let's read the translation. the rain has stopped, the clouds have drifted away, and the weather is clear again. If your heart is pure, then all things in your world are pure. Abandon this fleeting world. Abandon yourself, which is not a very literal translation, but sounds good. Then the moon and flowers will guide you along the way. We have this kind of experience. You walk out or maybe look through the window and then it's raining and the rain stops and the clouds part. And then it becomes clear, actually. That's exactly what we have here. Maybe you can see in the screen a little bit. So you have this kind of clear weather, and then he reflects on his life and his experiences. And this comes actually from the Vimalakirti scripture. If your heart is pure, then all things in the world become pure. It's a particular passage, but you find resonances with that in Chan records. And then this kind of sense of abandonment of this world, abandonment of oneself and openness to everything, including the beauty of nature is guiding the way. And finally, another point by Yokan, which brings us to kind of imagine the scene. He's in his hut, a small hut in the mountain, and it's at night and he's practicing meditation, right? At night, deep in the mountains, I sit in zazen, zuochan, or meditation. I sit in meditation. The affairs of men never reach here. In the stillness, I sit on a cushion across from the empty window. The incense have been swallowed by the endless night. My robe has become a garment of white dew. Unable to sleep, I walk into the garden. Suddenly, above the highest peak, the round moon appears. Ladies and gentlemen, I have some good news for you. The most beautiful things in life are free and available to all. The moon in the sky, the image of mountain peaks, especially, In fall, when the leaves are changing their colors, the sound of the bamboo moving in the wind, it's all there. And what spiritual practice, at least from this perspective, is indicating is that by pacifying the mind, by arriving at this point of stillness, by developing the capacity to go deep and to reflect, both to reflect, but also to be still, we also develop a capacity to enjoy life more fully, the capacity to look at the moon, to wonder, to find joy and pleasure by observing little things, the birds, a bird on a branch, a pattern of waves in the sea, the reflection of light, and so on. So I guess you can say that's one of the advantages of spiritual practice, if done well, if things work as these people say they work, is developing a capacity to enjoy a life in its fullness. Much more to be said, but I should stop. And this is finally, I'm not going over time, in part because I was reflecting on my tendency to talk too much. I still ended up talking perhaps too much, but maybe less than the last few times. So that means we have the time for questions. I don't know if there's some questions to address, and there's some, so I can open it. I have many questions right now, but I'm curious about your opinion on this one. How do you understand the phenomenon of Chan poetry is now interchangeable with Buddhist poetry. I think that the word Chancha, or maybe the expression Chancha, appears during the Tang in Buddhist poems written by poets such as Xie Lingyun, are not typically categorized as Chancha. Yeah, I mean, this is this problem of categories, right? How do you understand? Complicated. I mean, also, I addressed this partially when I was talking about Chan literature, right? What do we mean by Chan literature? What else? I mean, there are certain parts, like if it's, for example, if you look at Ryokan, he's a Zen priest, yes, identifying himself, he speaks about his Zen experiences and so on. So I guess you can put it into category of Zen poetry. But then when it comes to Hanshan, is it the Zen poetry? One way? Yeah. So what do you mean by Chan again? It's there are different layers and it depends on context and so on. It's not always a very, very clear cut, but kind of Chan and Buddhist poetry using interchangeably, yeah, it's helpful to be more clear, but at the same time, not to be overly hung up to this categories, to these rubrics and so on. If it's a good poetry, just enjoy it with the label of Chan or not. But yes, there is a tendency to, we like to put things into the category and put it under certain rubrics and then interpret. So for example, especially the poetry of some of the earlier poets, so kind of put it into the category of Chan. Why? Because it resonates. Actually, if you look at Xin Qin Ming, the inscription of 18 minor, actually there's nothing specifically Chan about that. You can say it's kind of more general statement about certain understanding of Buddhist truth and approach to spiritual cultivation and understanding of non-duality and so on. Also, like, a couple of weeks ago, when I was presenting a conference in California, so this paper I wrote was kind of dealing with the same issue. It was a paper by Zheng Guan, which is famous famous Huayan patriarch, the fourth patriarch of the Huayan school. But the essay is very, very generic in terms of kind of common understanding, and it reads really very much like a Chan text. If you're familiar with certain type of Chan sermonizing, and it's preserved in a Chan collection, but it's written or composed by a famous monk who is associated or with a Huayan tradition. So do you put it in the rubric of Chan or Huayan, or maybe some kind of mixture, or just something that is very, very generic, that is just essay on Buddhism for particular perspective and targeted for particular audience and so on. So it's the same. It's a good question. I'm afraid I'm not. I don't have time to go into too many details. But yeah, categories are important. So I'm not saying you shouldn't use the categories of Chan. So to say there is no Chan, so that's obviously nonsense. There was such a tradition. People identify with it, but at the same time. Especially as we interpret earlier texts through the lenses of these later categories, that can also be problematic. So we can use categories, but also to be aware that categories can be useful, but can also be reductionist or delimiting or maybe even misleading. So it depends on context and so on. But I agree, it's an important topic. So another question. Another famous poet, Li Bai of the Tang Dynasty, why you didn't include? I didn't include many poems. I already spoke for 2 hours. Yes, wonderful. I mean, you can use Li Bai, maybe a little bit less relevant. That's why I didn't include him in terms of the particular tradition I'm talking about. Sung Dynasty, indeed. Actually, if I can, of a friend of mine, if I can promote, this came a long time ago, but this was, I think, his first book. So this is about Susha and Buddhism in the writings of Susha and lots of Chan. So definitely you can you can have a Buddhist reading of Sucius poetry and go back to the Sung dynasty and so on. Yes, I agree. And I was thinking, I was tempted that I had only 2 hours to cover, but this is fascinating. I mean, yeah, you can do a whole book on this, and I agree, Sucius is great. And particular reason I'm more inclined, if I'm Tang dynasty to be much more interesting, I'm more familiar with it and so on. But having said that, I think this is coming from Kenneth, right? Thank you, Kenneth. It's a good point. So basically in a talk like this, you cannot cover everything, but definitely I hope maybe in the future we can have a whole series of Chan and poetry, maybe readings, maybe course somewhere and so on. I agree, reading Sushi is wonderful. Reading some other stuff, there are also female Chan masters, again, Beata wrote about it, that could be interested. There's lots of material, so you cannot cover everything. I was trying to kind of go to some of the material I personally find more interesting, and I've also studied, so I have more knowledge and expertise, but I also did quite a bit of research just for this talk, and this takes, maybe my talks look very, very unpolished in my presentations and so on, but actually I put lots of time into this, and especially considering that I also have many other things to do. But yeah, you cannot do everything. And also as you do more, and I kind of realize, oh, there's this another poet that might be interesting. I read a little bit, oh, this is interesting to look, find some articles and so on. It's unending. It's just, you have to set up your parameters and hope the audience will find what you have to say interesting and meaningful. And then maybe open the door also for further discussions, including discussions about Sushi and his poetry and Deepai and Buddhism. These are all wonderful topics, and I hope we will have opportunity to address them. Another question. Lipai, Lipo, Chan poet, or perhaps too wild, drunk, and curious, your thoughts. To tell you the truth, I don't know. I mean, I wouldn't consider him a Chan poet in a narrow sense. People who study, I was also reading some of the stuff about people who study poetry and literature, and many of them approach things in a very secular way, a little bit allergic to religion, actually, some of these scholars who did this kind of stuff. So they will freak out, I guess, some of them, if you put identify Lipo or Lipai as a Chan poet. But it's interesting to look. I haven't looked. I mean, I have read some of his poetry, but I haven't looked more carefully. So would you consider, from the top of my head, not really, but it's interesting to explore elements of Chan, again, with keeping in mind the basic problem or issue of how do you delineate what is Chan and what is not, to say, where you set up the boundaries and how you create these kind of different models of what particular traditions are and what separates them, what's distinctive and so on. But those are wonderful questions, and again, I hope.
So there is another question. I think if you go to the last from the YouTube.
From YouTube, yeah. Yeah, this brings, so this is from YouTube audience, and again, very good questions. And I think maybe we should have a whole session where we use different format where people can talk at the end and have question and answer, maybe a discussion. That would be wonderful. But under the circumstances, we have to go with this kind of chat feature. So a question from YouTube, at least the Lei Chan during the Tang Dynasty already seems to be some Sanjiao He is the harmony of the three teachings, Buddhism, Confucian, and Taoism is a major theme in the religious history of China. Ruiz writes, or Confucian writes, Taoist, hedonism, Chan scarcity, and so forth. What's your view? Yeah, I mean, I brought this issue when I was kind of references Baudry's writing about description of his cottage. That's how I use this books in his living room as a framing device. Of course, it could be just an offhand mention, but I think points to this kind of embrace of certain religious outlook informed by religious pluralism, which is very important for understanding Tang Dynasty Buddhism or Chinese religion more generally. I mean, of course, you had also fundamentalist types like Han Yu, for example, who pushes to this kind of narrow Confucian orthodoxy, and this becomes even more of a theme during the Sung Dynasty with the Daoxian movement. But yeah, this is a dominant theme in Tang Dynasty life, this kind of embrace of religious pluralism and seeing the three teachings as complementing each other and their mixtures. I gave a lecture long time ago. Some of my files disappeared, so I don't have a record of lost some of the files, including the PowerPoint I presented for that lecture. But I've been thinking about writing this, about how Baijiu's religious persona was constructed, and how you can see in some of his poetry and especially prose writing influences of Confucianism and engagement in Taoism, both philosophical Taoism, but also this kind of quest for immortality, the alchemy that was also important part of Taoist tradition during the time, and then Buddhism. So there are different possibilities of reading how these different traditions interact, both in terms of his personal life, but also in terms of his poetry. And actually, sometimes you can find references to Buddhism, Taoism, Confucianism in the same poem. Within a single poem, you can find those kind of different references to the different tradition. So yes, it's a very interesting topic also. And this Sanjia He Yi, the unity of the three teaching. Of course, there's also conflict between the three teachings, their competition and so on. So I'm not saying the history of Chinese religion is just this kind of beautiful harmony and so on, but this is an important ideal. And often it's an ideal that also plays out in terms of reality. So it's something, yeah, it's another good question. It's something worthy of considering. I think it's important. Having said that, to reduce Baijiu's life or spiritual endeavor or his practice to this kind of indiscriminate mixing of different traditions, I think it's also not quite correct. I mean, he identified himself very clearly in many of his poems and other writings as Buddhist. And if he decides to be buried in a Buddhist monastery next to the stupa of his Buddhist master, and if he writes that he wants to be reborn as a monk, I think that's pretty clear where his heart lies, though maybe our Taoist friend might have a different perspective on that. So kind of, yes, there is embrace of different tradition, but there are also certain commitments, spiritual commitments that he and others make. And then another question. Thank you. These are very good questions today. At least the late Chan during the Tang Dynasty. It's just repeated twice the same.
Yeah, I think he repeated the same.
Well, that's about it then. Thank you. Those were wonderful questions, and hopefully we will have opportunity for further discussion down the line. As Chinese Heirloom and Jie Yuan La, we have planted some roots, maybe digitally or virtually and so on. But I hope you find this to be interesting topics. As I was preparing this, again, I spent lots of time, but I kind of also found myself, you know, I could do much more with these materials. It's a fascinating topic, and certainly it's worth of much more attention, maybe more expertise than I can provide, but I tried my best within the limited scope of the time and the circumstances and so on to at least present some ideas, maybe introduce some points, and hopefully this is some kind of interest and appreciation of these very rich traditions, which is still there for us to enjoy, to appreciate, to engage with.
Okay, thank you, Professor, for today's wonderful lecture. And for the audience, next week we are going to have these eight lectures in this lecture series, eighth lecture on changing roles of the Chan masters and the institutionalization of Chan. So please join with us next week, same time, next Thursday. So thank you very much for today's wonderful lecture, Professor.
Thank you. Thank you for everybody. Stay well, and I hope to see most of you, or well, hopefully all and many others next week. So thank you. Stay well. Bye.
Okay, bye. Bye. So thank you.